married, be happy. And we are beginning to look at this thing called prayer. How awesome is it that we can just, at any moment, stop and just pray and communicate with God? It's such a blessing to be able to do that. Before we dive into the service, I just want to remind you, next Sunday evening, there is a family fun night at the Holiday Bowl. I think it's $3 for a game and free shoes. You can't get better than that. $3 is pretty cheap for a game of bowling. Free shoes is definitely cheap. So hope you're able to come out. I think it's at 5:30 next Sunday. So I hope you're able to come out to the Holiday Bowl next week. I'm going to pray in just a moment. And to begin that, I want to begin the word of prayer just by reading some scripture. And Pastor Pat's actually going to be preaching on this scripture here in just a couple of moments later in our service. But would you pray with me this morning? Philippians 4, beginning in verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Father God, in this place this morning, we want to rejoice in you. Lord, tomorrow, we want to rejoice in you. Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, the rest of the week, we want to rejoice in you. Lord, in whatever circumstance we go through this week, whatever goes on in our life, Lord, we can always come back and always rejoice in you. And why can we do that? The scripture says the Lord is at hand. It's God's work. God, you know everything. You know everything about our lives. You know everything that we're going to go through. So God, we pray that we just trust in you and we just rejoice in you. Lord, we're not just rejoicing in you to rejoice in you, but we were able to rejoice in you because you came and you saved us through Jesus' blood. So Lord, we pray that we put our faith and trust in that. And that gives us the strength to be able to rejoice. Lord, be with us this morning as we continue to worship you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. Will you stand with us and worship?
Thank you.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Heal my heart and make it clean. Open up my eyes to the things unseen. Show me how to love like you.
because he's great, we worship him. Because he's great, we give to him. And because he's great, we dedicate our lives to serving him and singing to him and being part of his mission. What an honor. What a blessing. What a great God we serve. I bet some of us have some pretty serious problems, some great problems that we brought into the door with us this morning that we just need to lay down at the feet of Jesus because he's greater. Whatever's going on in your life, he's greater and he's worthy of our praise. So I would like to ask you just to pray with me now if you bow your heads and close your eyes as we prepare to give our tithes and offerings. Lord, you are great. You are awesome. You are beyond our comprehension. And we love you. We truly appreciate the blood that you shed on the cross to purchase our freedom. We appreciate you. We magnify your holy name in this place today. But we're going to do it tomorrow and the next day and the next day in our homes, in our workplaces, in our cars. We just want to tell you what a great and awesome God you are. And the truth is, we fail. We are frail. We make mistakes. But you are so great. You are so good. And your mercy is new every single morning. We thank you for your amazing grace. We thank you that we can talk to you. We can take our burdens to you. We thank you that you'll forgive us when we ask you to. That you love us that much. And we pray that you truly will inhabit the praises of your people today and meet with us. Help us to sense your presence and help us to have peace. Help us to have joy. Help us to know you. Help each one of us to have an intimate, personal, private relationship with you, a vibrant prayer life. And now, Lord, I pray that you bless these tithes and offerings to further your kingdom's work here in Chesterfield and all around the world. In Jesus' name.
If they can move the mountains, let the mountains move. We come with expectation. Waiting here.
right. Please turn in your Bibles to Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4. We are talking today about the subject of prayer, peace, the peace that prayer brings in your life. And I've titled my message, Peaceful, Easy Feeling. Do you have a peaceful, easy feeling this morning? I hope so. I bet some of us don't, if we're honest. And when it comes to the subject of prayer, I think all of us wish God just answered every single prayer immediately, as soon as we ask. My niece, Mary Jo, just sang beautifully, always has. And I love her so much. Mary Jo Jimenez and her husband, Ethan, are here. He played the drums for us this morning. And she was our special guest musician. And I remember when she was just, when I was in college, she was born. I remember laying down on my back and putting her up on my foot, you know, and flipping her around on my foot when she was just a little baby. But a few years ago, she was our intern. 5 summers ago, she was our intern here, our SBCV intern here at Kingsland. And but the year before that, I got that dreaded call, that nightmare call from my brother saying Mary Jo was sick. And you know what? God healed her. God heals people. He does that. She is completely well. God healed her. And God fixes things. God provides our needs. He intervenes. He hears us. He cares about whatever you're going through. He loves you. Doesn't just love Mary Jo. He loves you too. And he doesn't, but you know what? I bet there's been a few prayers that we've prayed in the last 5 years that he didn't give us what we wanted to. Maybe you can relate to that too. Do you have a peaceful, easy feeling in your heart this morning? Do you want it? I do too. Is there a price tag we could put on peace? No way. I don't even think there's anybody even offering peace, like on commercials or something. Like a finance person might say, we'll give you peace of mind because they want you to, you know, invest your money or whatever. But nobody's really saying, we will give you actual peace, real peace. I don't know anybody that's so bold other than the Lord Jesus, the Prince of Peace. So let's read this passage in Philippians chapter 4. If we can turn the house lights on, I wonder if I'd be able to read it. And we're going to see that peace of mind is only made possible through an intimate relationship with Jesus Christ. I realize not everybody agrees with that. That's okay. They're wrong. Peace of mind, real true peace of mind, is the most valuable thing you could ever possess. I am preaching on a subject today that when I was just praying before I walked up here, I was like, Lord, let me have peace. Grant me peace. Sometimes I don't have it. You know, conflict and fear rob you of your peace. But that's two different things. Conflict just robs you of your peace. Marriage conflict, friend conflict, church conflict, it just robs you. Fear robs you of your peace. Sin destroys your peace. Have we all lived long enough to experience that? Sin just destroys your peace. Worry, anxiety are peace killers, obviously. And today, I want to talk about how to resolve some of that, how to deal with some of that. There's no doctor that can prescribe you a pill that will provide you peace. There's no drug. There's no person or possession that can give you peace. It's only available from God. It's completely inaccessible apart from Jesus Christ. Therefore, anything that comes in between you and God, it's a peace killer. It needs to be destroyed. And anything that draws you closer to God is a peace builder. And it needs to be emphasized. For instance, coming to church regularly, coming to church faithfully. Thank you, each and every one of you, for being in church today. I'm so glad you came. I really am. I believe this message could change your life. Not because I devised some awesome strategy. If you haven't, and I think we all, some of you are newer, so I'll be explicit about this. We are preaching and teaching the Word of God. So we can be so bold as to say, your life could be changed today. Definitely not by my clever jokes or ideas. And as beautiful as the music just was, that's not going to do it. It's the Holy Spirit of God. The Word of God, taking the Holy Spirit of God, could literally change your life. So these peace robbers, peace killers need to be eliminated, and the peace builders, the things that bring more peace into your life, reading Scripture, meditating, turning off all the devices for a little bit every day and just meditating on the Word of God. You know, the Buddhist and the Eastern religious people, they got meditating down, right? They meditate, and we're like afraid to talk about meditating like it's some weird thing or something. No, meditating is biblical. Meditate on the Word of God, serving Christ, living a holy life, singing His praises, listening to God-honoring music, worshiping Jesus. These are peace builders. And what we see in this text, praying. I don't know what we're going to do next week. I think we're going to preach the next thing in Philippians, I guess, but I'm still not 100% sure what we're going to do next week. We're not going to, I want to preach this thing, and next week we might do a little bit more of what I'm preaching about today. We might actually just do it. But for today, just understand this is all about prayer. When we say don't worry, be happy, what we're saying is don't worry, be happy in the Lord. And, you know, most of us think, I can't speak for you. I just run into a lot of people that thought, boy, if I could just have the right relationship. I mean, every other country song that's not about getting drunk or beating somebody is about that woman, that guy. If I could just have that person, I'd be happy. Well, and I guess every other rock song is too, right? You're my angel. Come save me. Some person. And when you're really in love, like I still am after 20 years of marriage, I can relate to that. I mean, my wife's awesome. I love her. And I love my kids. I mean, I've got great kids. I've got an awesome wife and family. But the truth is, and this might be sound offensive to some of you, but it's still not enough. God created each and every one of us for a relationship with Him, first and foremost. That is your primary relationship. And of course, if you're single and you want to be married, I believe it's probably God's will for you to be married. If you've had your heart broken, maybe you've been left or divorced or mistreated or I don't know, wherever you, widowed. I mean, a lot of us are at different places in this life. And if the only way you can be happy is to have Mrs. Perfect or Mr. Perfect, well, guess what? A lot of us don't have that. Can you still be happy? You betcha. Can you still have joy? You betcha. Here it is. And we're beginning on the verse we ended on last week because it's so important. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say, rejoice. Philippians 4, verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say, rejoice. And we said last week, the main point of that is in the Lord. It says rejoice twice, but you just can't do that other than in the Lord. Because life is too hard. There's too many circumstances that come our way that are too difficult. And at the same time, some of you are on cloud nine. The band, most of our band went on vacation last week to the beach and put the pictures every third or fourth minute about their, you know, they're doing the whatever they're doing. What's the thing? You go under the bar and sing the hokey pokey and singing and eating and dancing. And it was, I spent a week of misery just looking at them and thinking of how miserable my life was. So some of y'all are in cloud nine, and you've just been having a great time this week, and I'm happy for you. I really am, because you know, just as well as I do, you're going to work tomorrow morning, and it might not be quite that happy tomorrow. How can we find deep, abiding joy? How can we rejoice in the Lord, even when you have cancer, even when you're dealing with grief, even when you're coming back on vacation instead of looking forward to vacation? I've always noticed all these people on vacation. When I'm on vacation, it's nowhere near as fun as I imagine it being when all those other people are. Even those things, they're fun, they're great, but they don't necessarily satisfy completely. We have to rejoice in the Lord. He's the one who satisfies completely. Okay, new material, verse 5. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. That's an interesting word we'll look at in a little bit. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. I recommend you read and you memorize those verses. Like the old song says, take it to the Lord in prayer. We just sang about it today. In fact, I want to be a good example to you. Let's pray. Lord, your word says that we can have the peace that passes understanding. We're claiming that today as a promise from God. If we will make our request with thanksgiving. if we will take our burdens to you. You've given us a prescription for joy and peace in our hearts. And Lord, I perceive that this is something a whole lot of people under the sound of my voice really want and really need. So Lord, today we take our burdens as a church, as a nation, as individuals, as husbands, wives, singles, widows, widowers, children, teenagers. We lay them down at your feet. We are taking it to the Lord in prayer, and we are praying. And Lord, I am praying in Christ's name for the peace that passes understanding. I want to preach well. I want to teach well. I want to explain this thing well. But Holy Spirit of God, only you can change a heart. Only you can heal a broken heart. Only you can heal that physical body that needs to be mended. Only you can save a soul, and we pray that you would. And we pray that you would bring peace into our lives, and that each and every one of us would have peace because we have a relationship with the Prince of Peace, in whose name we pray. Amen. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. That's review. We're expected to face life's trials and tribulations with Christian joy. Our faith should be strong enough for us to keep a positive attitude, come what may. He's good all the time, and all the time he's good. Even when our circumstances are not good, from our perspective, we must choose to be happy. In fact, Dennis Prager, the author and radio host, is famous for that quote. Happiness is a skill. Complaining not only ruins everyone else's day, it ruins the complainer's day too. The more we complain, the more unhappy we get. End of quote. I am not a sociologist, a psychologist, or a happy-ologist. I don't know how to make you happy. I don't know how to keep myself happy most of the time. But I do know that joy is deeper than that. And we're told to have joy. Again, I say, have joy in the Lord. Rejoice in the Lord. So it's worth bearing, it's worth repeating, and these are some of the most significant verses in all of Scripture. All of Philippians 4 is worth memorizing. And we'll get into even more amazing verses as we go ahead. But what I decided to do, and if you have your bulletin, you can keep notes there on the back. I just broke this up into five action items. God's recipe for peace of mind. And I think we need to be proactive, because most of us have probably found that sitting around and hoping to be happy isn't working, right? So let's be proactive. Let's not sit back and sort of hope that we're going to be happy. Let's be proactive about it. So let's just break it up into five steps from this text. Number one, be gracious. Be gracious. Now, the context for this whole thing was those two ladies that were fighting. They couldn't get along. And we don't know who was wrong, who was right. It does matter, I guess, but not enough that Paul put it in there. People weren't getting along. And he's saying in verse 5, let your reasonableness, let your gentleness be known to everyone. Be gracious. Be gracious. Think Superman. He's the Man of Steel. He's undefeatable. He's strong. But he was meek and kind and gracious. Do you remember the football player? Some of you old timers will remember the football player, Merlin Olsen. He was a Hall of Famer. Big, huge, muscly guy. But very soft-spoken. Very sweet. Very kind. Very gentle. When he wasn't beating the mess out of guys on Sunday afternoons playing football. But the rest of the time. Super. In fact, I think he actually, after he beat somebody down, he'd help him up. You know, he's a nice guy. We need to be gracious. We need to be kind. Mary Jo has a brother who I performed her brother's wedding a couple weekends ago, and he's much bigger than me. He's a football player for Liberty University. But this guy, Ben, is the sweetest, nicest guy you'd ever want to know. Thank goodness. He's just a sweet guy. We can be gracious. We can be kind. If you don't treat others right, you'll never feel right. Think about that. If you don't treat others right, you're never going to feel right. Those ladies weren't treating each other right. They weren't getting along, and they didn't have peace. The word here, be reasonable, be gentle, it means to be content, to be generous, to be humble. It's talking about forbearance. It's talking about patience. If you have the old King James, it says, let your moderation be known. Be moderate. In everything in life, there's a balance. Eating is good. Overeating is bad, right? Partying is okay. The right kind of partying. Over partying is bad. Sleep is good. Sleeping all day is bad. Be moderate. have balance. But you know, hurting people often hurt people. On the other hand, forgiving people should be forgiving people. And we are forgiven people. We should be the most forgiving, gracious, kind people possible through the power of the Holy Spirit. God has been so good to each of us. Can I get an amen? Amen. He's been good to me. I don't even want to think about or have to sit here and talk about all the things he's forgiven me for doing, all the things he's given me that I didn't deserve. That's grace. Mercy is his forgiveness for things that we did that we should have been punished for. It was all laid on him on the cross. He forgave us for all of it. He's so incredibly good. So receive his love and his grace, and then turn around and share it with others. If you know Jesus, you need to turn around and share the love of God with others. If you do not yet know Jesus, just receive his grace and his love. And it's impossible to be at peace with yourself when you're bitter and angry at God and at others and resentful at others. Someone said bitterness is a toxic chemical. It's a poison that destroys the container that holds it. So make sure that your heart doesn't contain it. Step number one, be gracious. So And everything in the Word of God is counterintuitive. If you want to go up, you got to go down. If you want to be the greatest, you got to be the servant. And I want to be happy, so that means I should be able to go out and buy an ice cream cone like the guy passed in the, he was in a work van yesterday, maybe Friday, at 8 o'clock in the morning. And that dude was eating an ice cream cone on his way to doing whatever job. I was like, go get it, man. If you want an ice cream cone at 8 o'clock in the morning, God bless you. That's, you know, wonderful. But the more we take, that we don't feel better about ourselves. We feel better about ourselves when we give and when we're gracious. So let your reasonableness, your graciousness, your gentleness be known. The Lord is at hand. That brings us to number two. Remember, God is always with you. The Lord is at hand. He's watching. He's here. Knowing that God himself is present should change. Did my microphone come in and out? There it went. I think about my mom and dad, Mary Jo's grandparents. I mean, they're getting elderly. But when I'm around them, I mind my P's and Q's. I can remember my mother sticking a bar of soap in my mouth. Anybody else can remember that? Not my mouth, but maybe your mouth. Yeah, whatever. Not pleasant. Not pleasant. I still revere that woman and that man. How much more should I fear and revere God, my heavenly Father? You know, if I hung out with the Pope, I think I would, and I liked other popes better, but I wouldn't tell him that. I'd probably, you know, here's one. If I got to hang out with Robert Duvall, the greatest actor of our generation, I would think before I spoke. And that's just a man. An amazing, beautiful, bald-headed man. But I wouldn't just rattle on and on. I'd be measured. I'd think before I spoke. I'd watch what he did and then do what he did, I guess. K-Love did that. They did a survey this week. You know, what actor would you want to hang out with? I was like, Robert Duvall. No doubt about it. I don't know who's yours would be, but did you know William Shatner, the actor, is coming to Richmond? And again, he's kind of a goofball, but I would still probably watch what I said, hanging around him, watching, you know, Star Trek or whatever. These are people, insignificant human beings. Remember, God is real, and he really is with you. The Lord is at hand. And J.D. Greer taught a lesson recently on practicing the presence of the Holy Spirit. That's a phrase I think we should use more often. Practicing the presence of the Holy Spirit. That's an old phrase that I learned in college. And J.D. Greer is the president of the Southern Baptist Convention. He and I went to the same Bible Institute, Word of Life Bible Institute. And he taught a lesson on practicing the presence of the Holy Spirit. And it's available at the Gospel Coalition. If you go to that website, great website. The Gospel Coalition. Six ways to practice the presence of the Holy Spirit. Let me do them really quick. Number one, in the gospel. Sharing the gospel. God is with you when you share the gospel. Acts 1:8. Behold, I'm with you. when you go to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, the uttermost parts of the world, that's how we know you have the Holy Spirit, that you're sharing the gospel. Number two, through the Word of God. The Spirit's primary vehicle for moving and speaking in our lives is the Word of God. Be careful of these cats that want to tell you everything that God told them to tell you. It better not be in conflict with the Word of God. The Word of God is God's Word. And when we're in the Word of God, when we're studying the Word of God, we're hanging out with God. Practice the presence of the Holy Spirit through the church, worshiping at church, in your giftings. That's number four. In your giftings, each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. Each and every one of us have spiritual gifts to be used. And when you're singing, I talked to somebody, oh boy, recently just talked about, when I'm serving in my gifting, I feel so at home, I feel so fulfilled. Isn't that true? And you can. And it may be just shaking hands at the door and being kind to people, or feeding people on Monday nights. Those are two very different things. And we're gifted differently. Some of you are singers, some of you are teachers, whatever your gifting is. Understand that we practice the presence of the Holy Spirit in our giftings. Number five, in our spirit, your spirit man. He is spirit, and we have a relationship. And then lastly, number six, through circumstances. As you experience circumstances in your life, you realize God is right there with you. And sometimes he feels so far away, but I bet many of us have experienced when you're in pain, when you're in fear, when you're in a difficult time, he's right there. And you sense his presence like never before. He's always there when you need him. Now, on the positive side, it is comforting to know that our Heavenly Father is nearby at all times, wanting to hear from you and help you. Isn't that wonderful? Take advantage of his constant presence. He is with you 24/7. So be gracious to others and practice the presence of the Holy Spirit. Isaiah 41:10, fear not. For I'm with you. Be not dismayed, God says. I'm your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you with my righteous right hand. He wants to do that. He's right there with you. Therefore, let's move on to number three. Reject anxiety. Reject anxiety. The verse goes on to say, if you're still there in Philippians, chapter 4, verse 5, do not be anxious about anything. It's so easy for me to say those words. Do not be anxious about anything. And the truth is, my wife could rat me out right now and tell you, he's anxious about all kinds of stuff. And I am. I get keyed up. Our children on Friday night, it's very rare this happens. All three of our children were in away. Our daughter went away on a trip. Our sons went out at a birthday party. All of them were gone. It was lonely. And in fact, she went to bed early, and I'm sitting there thinking, man, this stinks. But I began worrying about my children. Well, what if they get into medicine, or what if there's an accident, or what if someone, you know, robs the house, or aren't we all tempted to worry about our loved ones? Even that is outlawed in this text. Do not be anxious about anything. God is near. So what do you have to worry about? God is near. So what do you have to fear? That's catchy. You can remember that, right? God is near. What do you have to fear? God has not given us a spirit of fear or timidity, but of power and love and a sound mind. 2 Timothy 1:7. Remember, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. And I'm sure we all get intimidated or fearful at times. It's only human nature. But we must overcome that fear and anxiety by trusting in Christ, by trusting his promises. His promises are greater. And peace of mind comes when we trust the Lord more than we worry about what we could lose. So the best thing to do is just lay it all down at his feet and say, I lose it all. I don't want any of it. The mindset of all my possessions, all of my accolades, my job, my spouse, my kids, my future, whatever I have, I just lay down at the feet of Jesus and trust him to take better care of the things you hold dear than you can yourself. Give it all away to God, the same God who gave away everything to redeem you. He has earned the right to be trusted, hasn't he? He is our Redeemer. He purchased us. We were lost in sin. He bought us back. Remember, you're bought with a price, therefore glorify God. So that's true. It's reality. He's near. We can trust him. We can let go of our anxieties. All of my problems are really his problems. Now, let's get into the meat of this thing. Number four, one word, pretty obvious. Pray. Pray. The point of this text is stop worrying and start praying. Worrying is like sitting on a rocking chair and rocking, thinking you're going to get somewhere. You don't. You just rock and worry. We need to pray. So here it is. In everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. This is a four-part, four-week sermon series in one verse. But let's condense it a little bit here. In everything, that's another big word, right? Don't worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. So we're talking about supplicating, thanking, interceding, and requesting. That's kind of how I broke it down. Supplicating, asking God to supply your needs. Look down just a few verses, down to verse 19. My God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in Christ Jesus. Remember it, claim it, pray it, make it personal. Whatever it is you need, he's going to supply. He doesn't give us our greeds, he gives us our needs. Thanking him, worshiping God passionately 24/7. You've had an opportunity to do that today. I hope that you'll do it all week long. Just worship him. Some of us need to change the radio dial. Some of us need, does anybody still use CDs? You put CDs in the thing and it sucks it out, and you put it in and sucks it out. Yeah, mine got jammed. So I've made a big leap into the world of technology. I'm listening to my phone now, which is very interesting because my son found one of these things. Remember the cassette tapes that had a wire you could plug into your CD player? That's been a long time ago. A CD player? Well, my son has a cassette tape deal with the wire that you can plug into your phone. So my car is old enough. I play my phone through a cassette. It still has a cassette player, and I can listen to my music that way. Whatever some of you are back to using vinyl records. God bless you, whatever. 8-tracks, I don't care. Some of us need to change our music habits. If you're being brought down, music is to glorify and honor the Lord. And there's nothing wrong with the good songs about people and relationships and all that too. But my goodness, some of us need to think about how we're worshiping Christ. Some of us spend a lot of time in the car. I spend a lot of time in the car. And I spend a lot of time worshiping the Lord. And I hope that you will do that. Interceding. Asking God on behalf of others. Requesting, thanking, interceding, or supplicating, thanking, interceding. What percentage of your prayers are totally for other people other than yourself? That's probably a tricky question for a lot of us, because I pray about myself all the time. I feel kind of hypocritical even bringing it up. You need to pray for others. God hears when you pray for others. Pray for someone else. Pray for someone else's needs, and God will bless you. And then lastly, requesting, casting all your cares on God. Requesting. And by the way, I kind of skipped this. Our prayer points, our prayer guide is right available to you there. You can grab this anytime you want. And it has hundreds of names and things to pray about for others. Your name might be on there too, but use this thing. Use it. We need to be a praying church. Dwight L. Moody said, Every great movement of God can be traced to a kneeling figure. That's Dwight L. Moody. Oswald Chambers said, prayer does not fit us for the greater work. Prayer is the greater work. And we forget that because we're busy, we're distracted. Praying is not just a wish list with God. Praying is hanging out with God. He's real. He loves you. He's more important than all those goofy names of people I mentioned earlier. He is even more important than your own father. And many of you would just give everything, anything, just to hang out with your father one more time. Because maybe he's already in heaven. Or some of the exact opposite. Some of you didn't have a good relationship or don't have a good relationship with your father. Just understand, your heavenly father is real and he wants to connect with you. Vance Havner said, the thermometer of a church is its prayer meeting. The thermometer of a church is its prayer meeting. Jim Cimbala said, persistent calling upon the name of the Lord breaks through every stronghold of the devil. For nothing is impossible with God. If you want to break through the devil's strongholds with your children, in your home, at work, in our church, in our community, pray. Nothing is impossible with God. For Christians in these troubled times, there is simply no other way. So our meetings aren't going to do it. Our good intentions aren't going to do it. Even making a commitment here. I'm going to start. That will not fix our problems. It's prayer. It's totally relying on the Lord. One more quote from David Jeremiah, my favorite. Prayer is the way you defeat the devil, reach the lost, restore a backslider, strengthen the saints, send missionaries out, cure the sick, accomplish the impossible, and know the will of God. David Jeremiah. So if that's the case, how much time did you spend praying this week? Is it something you just kind of zip through in the morning, zip through at night, or zip through for a meal? If you want the peace of God, the formula is absolutely black and white here. It is right there in front of you. If we want the peace of God that passes understanding, we're going to have to spend time in prayer, in supplication, with thanksgiving, letting our requests be known to God. Pray. We're going to have an invitation in just a moment. Pray. You can pray now. Just pray. Number five, in closing, open your heart and mind to God daily. Open your heart and your mind to God on a daily basis. We need to quit. Man, the spiritual highs of the past are great, but we need to stop thinking that our Christian life is somehow predicated on these big events when it's really predicated on every single day. It's kind of like getting married. You had that big event of getting married. But a strong marriage is a daily thing. Open your heart and mind to God on a daily basis, and He will fill your heart. He will fill your mind with peace and joy and hope. Look at verse 7. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Have you lived long enough, or have you heard enough about really strong Christian men or women who totally fell into some nasty stuff to realize all of us need to have a guard over our hearts? All of us are susceptible to being sucked into things that are really bad for us. We're all capable at any point in our lives of going the wrong direction. We need a guard over our hearts and a guard over our minds, and that's the Holy Spirit. Look at verse 7 again. If you will do this, if you will pray, if you will make supplication and offer thanksgiving and make your request made known to God, the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. So His presence brings peace that is behind comprehension. His presence guards our hearts and our minds. And I need it. I need more of it. And I have failed. I have forgotten. I've been asleep at the switch, probably like some of you have too, at times. We need to open our hearts and our minds. If you're not a believer, I encourage you, just invite Christ to come into your life and save you today. Trust Him. Repent of the bad stuff. And what that means is turn around from the bad stuff and just trust Him to save you. And don't get confused when I say that. That does not mean that somehow you can clean up your act and that God will save you. No, God saves you and He cleans up your act for you. We've got stuff on us called sin that only a celestial power washer can wash it off. And God has it. The blood of Jesus will wash away your sins if you will receive it. And so that's for the person who comes to Christ brand new, or the person who's known the Lord a long time. But I'm just asking, will you open your mind? Will you think about this differently than you have before? Will you really activate this is the Magna Carta, man. This is the texts. This is something that should be preached all the time. I need this. You need this. Every one of us that want peace in our hearts and our minds desperately need this. Will you open up your mind? Open up your heart to what God is telling you today. I want to tell you something that happened to me this week in closing. And this kind of goes back to the person that might be listening that has not yet opened up their mind and their heart to Jesus. I met an individual this week. I received information about a person that was dying. And I was, an old friend asked me to go visit this person who was dying. And Pastor Justin visited the man too on Friday, last Friday, and then I visited him on Monday. And I've never met this man before. I don't know him. He doesn't know me. And I walked in, and he was sleeping. And it was one of those odd situations where the nurses and everybody completely left us alone. They didn't come in. There was no roommate. It was just me and him. And but he was deep, deep in sleep. He was dying. And I tried to talk to him. I tried to wake him up. I prayed for him. I prayed out loud for him. I prayed the Lord would wake him up just for 5 minutes so I could share the gospel with him. And I didn't shake him or anything. I didn't want to get arrested by some crazy nurse coming by or something. But I did get in his ear, and I gave him the gospel. But if you've ever shared the gospel with someone who's actually snoring out loud, I mean, it was obvious. I don't want to say snoring. It might have been the death rattle. He was dying. And he wasn't listening to me. And they say, you know, hospice people say people can hear deep into, and I don't know, maybe he did hear me. I'll never know because he died just a few hours later. I guess I won't know till I get to heaven. But the reality of it is, I was too late. I mean, that's just real. And I'm not trying to be manipulative or anything, but I was too late. Pastor Justin was too late. It was interesting to hear that there was a friend that had visited him that that knew the Lord and was trying to share the gospel with him. So somebody, I think, got there, hopefully. But in my personal situation, I was too late. And here's the, again, I don't know all the science behind it, so I'm not trying to cause trouble, but here's the deal. It was too late for him. It was too late for that guy. He was already dying and almost dead on his deathbed just a few hours before he died. It was too late. There will come a time when it's too late. You understand that? God is so gracious. He's so loving and he's so merciful, and we concentrate on that and we share that everywhere we go. But there is a time when it's now too late. It's over for him. Whatever he was going to do with Jesus, it's happened. It's done. So while you're of sound mind and while your ears are open physically, I would say open up your heart and your mind to what Jesus wants to do for you before it's too late. If you need to give your heart to Christ, just do it today. Ask him to save you. Ask him to forgive you. He will. He will give you heaven if you just ask for it. Now, all of us want peace of mind, but many of us don't have it because we're neglecting one or two or three or four or all five of these essential activities. So, in review, are you gracious? Do you practice the presence of the Holy Spirit? If not, talk to the Lord about it right now. If you're crippled by anxiety, take that to the Lord. How strong, how consistent is your prayer life? That is where we find the peace of God that passes understanding. Are you opening your heart and your mind to God? Or are we opening our minds and our ears to lesser things? We're all tempted to do that all the time. I hope that you will receive the peace that only God can give you right now. Would you pray with me? As we bow our heads and close our eyes and prepare for our time of invitation. Will you receive the peace that only God can give you? Do you need it? I sure do. Lord, I pray that you would help each one of us to receive the things you have for us, that we would be quick to open up our hands and say, Lord, whatever it is you want from me, your peace, your joy, your filling, your presence, and that we wouldn't fill our hearts and our minds with lesser things. Lord, I pray for the one who has been cantankerous and difficult, that he would be gracious and repent. Lord, I pray for those who have lived their lives as if you're not even around, that today we would take a different approach. And Lord, I'm worried about that one, that man, that woman, that young person who is crippled with anxiety. pray that you'd help them through that. It's real. It's so hard. Depression is real. These are serious issues that many of us have dealt with. Lord, I pray that each and every one of us that name the name of Christ would build a strong, consistent prayer life, and that we could truly know what it is to have the peace that passes understanding, even during life's hardest times. Lord, I pray for the one who needs to be born again, that he or she would receive you by praying, by repenting, by confessing you as Lord, trusting in you, in your finished work on the cross, your resurrection. Lord, I just pray that you do a mighty and awesome work in our church and in our lives. Help us to truly know what it is to experience the peace of God, our Savior, on a regular basis. Help me to know what that is, and help each and every one of us to walk in that and to take advantage of this invitation to do business with God in Christ's name. Let's stand together. You don't have to sing. You can just pray where you are. You can come and pray here if you'd like and ask the Lord to help you with one or two or three, however many of these things you're dealing with, so that you can experience the peace that he wants you to have on a daily basis. And if I can pray for you, I'm here to do that. If you want to join our church, or if you want to be born again, if you want to open your heart to Jesus today, come and let me pray with you. If you want to be baptized, come forward and ask for that. Let's not just let this moment pass by. Let's truly, each and every one of us, let's experience the presence of God and have him do a work in our hearts that really, really need it. Come as God leads you.
Old things have passed away. Your love has stayed the same. Your constant grace remains the cornerstone. Things that we thought were dead are breathing in life again. You caused your sun to shine on darkest nights. For all that you've done, we will pour out our love. This will be our anthem song. Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love you. You are the one our hearts adore. Hopeless have found their hope. Orphans now have a home. All that was lost has found its place.
Deacon of the week to come up and pray, and congratulate Chris and Amy Finns. Their daughter got married here yesterday, so we rejoice for Megan. Also want to congratulate Mr. Ed and Mrs. Mary Faggart on 48 years of marriage on Tuesday. How about that? That is impressive. This is our last week of home groups this Wednesday night, so I hope y'all will take advantage of that. And get ready for the big, fun family bowling night next Sunday. I know it sounds kind of, you know, like, what? It's a great time of fellowship. It's a great time to meet people and hang out. And just, you don't have to bowl. I haven't bowled in 10 years. But you can play cards or Pac-Man or drink Coke or whatever it is you want to do. And I hope that all of us will be there Sunday night for that fellowship. It's going to be great. William, we dismiss our service.
Please pray with me. Dear Heavenly Father, as we go from this place, guide us and direct us in our walks throughout this week. Hedge protection around us. Let us always remember you the day in the mornings when we wake up to pray, and to also in the evenings when we come home, and also when we go to sleep at night, Lord. Allow us to always remember you, take you with us in all that we do. Allow you to be a part of every decision that we make in this coming week. Guide us now in heaven.
Hi, my name is Pat Fiordelise. I'm the pastor here at Kingsland Baptist Church. I want to thank you for choosing to watch our service tonight here on Comcast Cable. We're here every Friday night at 6 o'clock, and we truly appreciate that you watch it. And I do want to extend an invitation to you to come join us right here on a Sunday morning at 11 o'clock at Kingsland. We're located at 8801 Perrymont Road here in Richmond, Virginia. And if you want to find out more information about our church, it's available at kingslandbaptist.com. You know, tonight you may have made a decision to give your heart to the Lord. And if you did, we're so happy for you. We'd love to hear from you. If you haven't yet, we want to encourage you to receive Christ as your personal Savior. Ask Him to forgive you of your sins. Make Him the Lord of your life. And He died for you. He rose from the grave on the third day. And He said, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved if you'll confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is the Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you'll be saved. So if you want someone to talk to about that, call me here at the church. That's 275-1285. Or you can email me at pastor@kingslandbaptist.com. I'd be glad to talk with you about that. Our mission is to connect people with Christ. That's what we do. And you can watch all of our services at our website. Keep watching us on Comcast or come see us personally. We would love to meet you. God bless you. Good night.
Yeah.